That excellent demonstration. That was really fantastic.
You had fun doing it.
Great. Got a few questions. I'll begin with Don. I'd like you to tell us, Don, a little bit about the Bi-County Ambulance Service. How large is the organization and what areas do you serve?
Well, it started in 1976 by Kelly Bumpus and Kenneth Van Winkle. It's growing now to, we have 6 units, 3 on duty 24 hours a day, 3 backups. We have 25 employees. We cover all of the Yuba and Sutter County area, going up as far as LaPorte during the winter due to the snows.
And where is your office located?
Right now we're located at 1499 Market Street, Yuba City. We have 3 substations, 1 in Linden, 2 in Yuba City.
And how many ambulances do you have in the service?
3 on 24 hours a day and 3 backups, which we put on as needed.
And how many what employees do you have, and what are the different employees that you have? What types of classifications do they have?
Well, we have 11 EMT2s, which is the advanced life support training.
EMT meaning emergency medical technician.
Right. We have 12 EMT1s, which are the basic level of emergency care. We have 4 right now that are going through the EMT2 class that will be certified here in about 2 months.
Great. So your care involves from arriving on the scene in the ambulance to the emergency center at Rideout. Do you get involved once the patient's in the emergency center?
We assist a lot when things get busy and stuff. They need extra hands and stuff, and we're always there to help out.
Right, I've seen you involved over there. It's pretty impressive.
Thank you.
Ruth, people often complain about waiting times in emergency rooms and about the large amount of paperwork involved. I understand that Rideout's quite efficient, though, and very quick in seeing emergency patients, which is very impressive. Could you tell us a little bit about waiting times and how do you determine who gets care next? How is a priority established?
Well, the priority is established directly on what's wrong with the patient. Yes, we do have some waiting times, mostly for patients that are what we classify as non-emergent. The whole objective of the emergency room is to treat the patient who has a life-threatening condition. Those patients are seen without wait. They are taken in even if, you know, we're busy and treating other patients. Those patients are taken in immediately and given immediate care. Because of that, some of the people who have maybe uncomfortable conditions, and they may not be happy about it, but if their condition is not life-threatening and not where they're going to lose a limb or something like that, then they just have to wait. We try very hard to at least have them be seen by a nurse or someone to make sure that they're not, that's called triage, to make sure that they're not going to get any worse while they're waiting. And we try to keep everybody posted as to why they have to wait. Sometimes when things are really hectic and in emergency business, either it's all go or no go. You very often have, you're so swamped that just trying to get people ongoing through the system takes a little bit longer.
I guess a lot of this waiting seems to come about because people don't know when they should really be using an emergency room. A lot of patients should be going to their private physician or other facilities. What type of patient really should be at the emergency room?
The type of patient that we really are dedicated to are the patients that are severely injured or severely ill. We are open on a 24-hour basis, and a lot of the private physicians are not. A lot of the public clinics are not. So after hours and weekends and holidays, of course, we take everybody, and we're happy to see anyone that comes through with any kind of an injury or an illness. If you have the opportunity to contact your own doctor or make an appointment for a minor illness, then we prefer that they do go to their private physician. That isn't always available, and sometimes people are too uncomfortable to wait. So I also have my own theory. The American people have become a 24-hour society. You can go to the stores and shop 24 hours a day, and there are some people who also feel that they should get medical care 24 hours a day. We are there, so we do see them.
Ruth, people think of the emergency room as being a very exciting place to work, but not everybody can be a doctor or a nurse or an emergency medical technician. Are there any other careers that can get people somewhat involved in emergency care?
Oh, sure. The emergency room utilizes all of the ancillary services of a regular hospital, so we are in need of laboratory technologists, x-ray technicians, respiratory therapists. They are the three services that are called on virtually every critically ill patient, and we have to work hand in hand with all three of those services around the patient.
We saw a few of those in our film, too.
That's correct.
That's very good.
It's the diagnostic procedures to determine how critically ill a medical patient is, or you know, just the amount of blood loss, et cetera, for a trauma patient requires these technologists in order to diagnose it.
And I think a lot of people can take some of these courses at the Yuba College as
well.
That's
right. Yuba College does offer. We have, in fact, the hospital sponsors these student x-ray technicians, and they work through the emergency room with us for training.
But even if there's not a present need for more people in this field right in our counties, there may be needs in other parts of the state.
Oh, for sure.
Especially the more rural areas.
It isn't just the hospitals, too, that utilize x-ray technicians. A lot of the orthopedic physicians have x-ray units in their offices. Large clinics have them also, so the job opportunity is pretty good.
It can be a pretty rewarding field, I think.
It's a very rewarding field. I think any part of the health system is. I've enjoyed it.
Don, you work with so many people in your ambulance service work. Have you had any unusual stories that you could tell us, any unusual incidents that come to your mind?
Probably the one that's most common is getting to a scene without arriving first, and not knowing what you're arriving to, going on an unknown problem, and then finding some people that have been stabbed or something, and then getting out of the ambulance and seeing that person there welding a knife and asking you to leave.
Has anyone ever come at you with a knife?
Well, we've had a few incidences where, you know, we've been
attacked.
Attacked.
What do you do?
Run.
You carry a mace or anything like that?
No,
You can't do anything like that. You can't do that, I guess.
Well, we protect ourselves, but usually, you know, we just try to get away.
Right. If a citizen sees an accident or someone needs help and they decide to start CPR, is the EMT, the emergency medical technician, going to be angry with them when they see them trying to help out, when they want to get in there and help the patient?
We'll never say anything to anybody that's coming in to give us a hand, you know, doing CPR, you know, if they know what they're doing. It's the ones that you get in an auto accident or something, and they're pulling them out, trying to help them, you know, and they're really not doing any help for the patient if there's a broken back or a broken neck involved.
What can you do that doesn't need a doctor's consent or does need a doctor's consent? That's always been a confusing area for me. As an EMT, you're out there without a physician, and you have a lot of responsibility. When are the times... present when you have to call in and get, you know.
We try to call in on every incident, but if we're having like radio trouble or if we come on a CPR or something, we have standing orders to where we go ahead and we follow through.
Go ahead.
Full arrest.
So if someone's heart's not beating, you can start the IV.
We start the IV, defibrillate, give the cardiac drugs.
Use the electricity on the chest, just like on the emergency TV show that used to be on NBC. Right. Ruth, are there any general rules that you have for telling people when they should call an ambulance rather than waiting at home for the doctor to call them back when they've left a message with an answering service, or when they should get in the car and drive to the hospital themselves?
Yes, some of it is common sense, but a lot of people tend to deny that they're having some sort of a real life-threatening problem. I think any time that someone has chest pain, chest pain that's unusual, that's causing them a great deal of discomfort, if they're having respiratory problems, they should get to a doctor whether or not they've already notified their own doctor. And the easiest way is to call an ambulance. The ambulances have basically the emergency room on board. Because the EMTs are in radio contact with the physician, they can go ahead and start any necessary treatment at the time. The other times are when people have incidents and accidents at home. Some of our worst patients have come into us by car. They drive up on the back ramp and you go out and find someone who has fallen off a roof, fallen out of a tree, something where they have injured their back, the spine, some injury to a major bone. And at that point, people become panicky. They don't always use good judgment. and they can do a whole lot more damage to the patient than if they had called an ambulance. All the ambulance technicians are trained to stabilize before they transport, and they take care of each bone. They go over the whole body to make sure that there are no fractures, and then they immobilize the person as they are transported, and that protects protects them and doesn't cause any more damage. But we also get ambulance calls for cut fingers, little cuts on toes, and sometimes it's just a panic reaction, but those things really should come in by private car. if they don't look at the fact that it's ambulance transport, number one, it's very expensive.
Right.
Then number two, if the call comes out as someone bleeding, then the ambulance goes out code 3, which means they are using lights and sirens and are attempting to get there most expeditiously. That sometimes could endanger the lives of the technicians.
Right.
And that
you always read about auto accidents.
We hate to see that occur for something where the bleeding turns out to be a small cut.
Absolutely. Right. We often hear of the terminology trauma center versus emergency center.
Mm-hmm.
What is the difference?
A trauma center, and these are becoming very popular through the American College of Surgeons now, is a major hospital that has an operating room crew, an anesthesiologist, and surgeons capable of handling any injury, be it neurosurgery, orthopedics, or just general surgery, in the facility on a 24-hour basis. The smaller rural hospitals cannot support that kind
right.
of a
You can't have a surgeon
system.
There 24 hours a day waiting.
That's correct.
Three surgical teams on full time.
It's a very expensive proposition. We are classified as an emergency center, and we have excellent response from surgeons and OR crews, so that normally we can get the patient to the OR within minutes, but they are just not in the facility on a 24-hour basis as a trauma center is.
Well, we're running out of time now. I just wanted to finish by asking Don, how does one get an ambulance to your house if you need it one to get there?
911.
Just pick up that phone, 911.
911.
And how long does it usually take for one to get to the house when you're ready?
Depending on the area, if it's within the city or if it's up in the foothills, our crews are within a receiving a call or in the unit within 1 minute. And just depending, like I said, if it's up in the foothills, it'll take quite a bit longer. We do have a CHP officer that is an EMT-2 that works the foothills and is doing an excellent job up there.
Great.
He saved numerous lives.
I bet. I'd like to thank my guests, Ruth Pedneault and Don Morton, for joining us on the Medical Explorer tonight. I'd like to invite you to write to me at the Marysville Medical Clinic with your suggestions for areas and people that you'd like to see on this program. The Medical Explorer is a public service program, and I really do want to hear from you with your comments and suggestions. Please write to me at the address you see on the screen at the Dermatology Department, 800 3rd Street, Marysville, 95901. In our next show, the Yuba Sutter Medical Explorer will take you behind the scenes of the Fremont Hospital Nursery. We'll meet doctors and nurses who have brought many of us into the world as newborns and see some of the modern medical equipment that helps make the Fremont Nursery one of the best in Northern California. I'm Dr. Robert Peppercorn, your Medical Explorer. Thank you for joining us tonight, and have a good evening.